Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
All right, let's bring in Dave Zangaro now from Philadelphia. Dave, first of all, how have you been?
Doing well, man. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thanks for asking, Dave. Appreciate that. Okay, so here we are. This is, for some people, a national holiday, and for some people, it's a fun work day. Eagles have two picks. Dave, a year ago, we would have been debating at pick 10, do they take a quarterback? That was immediately solved by Jalen Hurts. Now they can really go to town and pick whomever they want. Your idea, which direction should they go?
Yeah, it's you're right. It's funny how different a year ago feels right now. We were talking about when they made that trade with the Saints to pick up a future one. We thought maybe that's going to be ammo to get the quarterback. They obviously don't need that. So in Philly, I mean, obviously the fan favorite is Bijan Robinson. I have a hard time believing that's the way they would go, just based on what we know about how they value positions. So I think it starts with the trenches with this team like it normally does, and there will be some options. Now, it's a little tricky to figure out exactly how this board in front of them is going to go, but if Jalen Carter is there at 10, or if he starts slipping into their range, I think he's a player that just makes a lot of sense for them positionally, and given what we know about the individual player, he is not without question, of course, right now. There's legitimate off-field concerns, but if he checks out in that regard, the prospect is a really good one, and they've obviously drafted Georgia players recently. They drafted two last year, so I think that would make some sense if they want to have a modest trade up and figure out a way to get Jalen Carter.
Hey, Dave, it's Matt Cotrello. Sorry we had some technical difficulties there on Steve's end, but we'll keep things going. Anything you're hearing at this point as far as where the Eagles might go tonight?
Yeah, it's a little tricky to figure out. I think the trenches are a pretty safe bet, but that's not unlike a lot of years. I think it makes sense that they would try to trade up if one of those top defensive players falls, and I think Jalen Carter's at the top of that list. So if they're you know, 7 or 8, then I think it makes a lot of sense.
Let's get back to Jalen Carter for a second. Oh, we do have Steve back. Okay, here we go.
Okay. Yeah, I know you're obsessed with Jalen Carter. Get off that. They're not going to get him. I mean, seriously, they're not going to get him. They got a better shot at Nolan Smith. I want to get into Robinson for a moment. If he's available at 30, I'd take him. What about you?
Yeah, sure. I mean, 30 is much different than 10. But getting back to Jalen Carter, I don't think it's like out of the realm of possibility. It would take a trade up. I wouldn't just say they're not going to get him.
Oh, I think Seattle's going to take him at 5. That's why I say it.
Okay.
I'm not saying they wouldn't take him. I'm saying Seattle will take him at 5. I don't think he's on the board.
Yeah, I mean, that's legitimate. I also think that if the Eagles make a call about Seattle's pick, that's not crazy. I know it would be a big jump. But if he makes it past 5, then all bets are kind of off.
Well, hey, Dave, let me ask you this then. What if the Eagles were to couple 10 and – was it the Eagles are 10, right? 10 and 30
yeah.
together to get 5. Would that be worth Carter?
That's an interesting question. Part of my whole thinking was a trade-up was that you could then trade down from 30 and recoup some of those picks. I think Carter is a special player. Moving up that high, that's risky, right? That's certainly
right.
Risky.
Yes.
I think he is a really good player. I don't know if they would package both of those picks to move up that far.
Okay, Matt, go ahead. Let him have it on Carter. Go ahead. Matt is not a Carter guy, Dave. Go ahead, Matt.
I the only thing I question is I just don't think it. I think the Eagles can't afford to take a chance on him at this point because of the short window that they have. That's just my personal opinion about that. I don't know how you feel about that, Dave.
Well, look, I think the short window stuff is people bring it up when they talk about a prospect like Bijan, right? It's like they want to maximize this window that they have open right now. I don't think that's the way they look at these high first-round picks. Right now they have a top-10 pick coming off a Super Bowl appearance, and that's really rare. I think that they're trying to find the guy who's the cornerstone of the franchise for the next decade. So I get that there are some questions. And, look, I can't really speak to the off-the-field concerns. They're doing their homework on all that. I can tell you the player himself is impressive. And I think the Eagles also feel like they have the culture to take a chance when there is a little bit of a character concern. They've put that in place with their quarterback, their leaders. And, I think Philly, even with N'Kobe Dean and Jordan Davis already in the building, they feel like they'd be able to handle Jalen Carter.
Dave, with all due respect, every team thinks that. I mean, they all do. Every team thinks.
Well,
we can handle
it. He's off with some boards.
I know that. But I'm saying a lot of teams, like when it comes to somebody, we can do it. I'm not so sure. But Carter's a talent. There's no getting around it. But he's got his buddy there, his teammate, Nolan Smith. Would he fit at 10? And even though he may be a bit undersized, would he be what they're looking for off the edge?
Yeah, I don't think the Eagles would be as concerned about the measurables there.
I agree.
They have Hassan Reddick, who, it's funny. Hassan Reddick has been kind of the poster child for undersized defensive ends or edge rushers, whatever you want to call them. So I don't think they'd be too concerned about that. Now, you look at Nolan Smith's production in college and you think, you'd like to see a little bit more there, but he's playing for a really good team, and sometimes the numbers just don't follow. I think he's one of those guys where you can convince yourself the best is yet to come, and you hope it is, because the production hasn't been there. But the words physical freak kind of get tossed around pretty freely now. No, he is. I mean, he's quite an athlete, and I think he would be in play at 10, or even a possible, a modest trade down. He would still be a target, I think.
Yeah. Okay, offensive line. In all likelihood, Peter Skoronski might be there. At 10, is that a possibility? And what would you think of it?
Yeah, I think there are really two offensive linemen who might be in play at 10. It's Skoronski and Paris Johnson, if Paris Johnson's still there. Interesting, because they're similar in some ways and different in others. You know, Skoronski has kind of been pegged as a guard at the NFL level. He's never played guard at college, and Paris Johnson did play guard a little bit in college, started at right guard for a year, but has the length and the athleticism. Everyone kind of thinks he's going to be a tackle. I think with Skoronski, it's going to come down to which teams think he's a guard only and which teams think he has the ability to play tackle in the NFL, because those guys are obviously more valuable. You don't see a lot of guards going in the top 10. We saw Quentin Nelson, of course, a few years ago, special prospect, though. The last time before then, you have to go back to 2013 to find a guard only in the top 10. So it is rare. He feels like a really safe pick because his college tape is so good. And look, with the Eagles, I don't think them going to the trenches is ever a surprise.
Right, no. And obviously, I saw both those players play in person, Paris Johnson and Peter Skoronski. Robinson aside, are there a couple of playmaking guys out there? And I might be thinking 30 now. That
sure.
When you look at it,
I don't know if the value lines
like,
up at 10 necessarily for a skill player.
But if you're
looking at 30, and then you get into the Jahmyr Gibbs isn't a crazy pick. I don't know if there's a receiver
he's the running back from Alabama. Sorry, go ahead.
No, of course. Yeah, and he has that the ability as a receiver too. So that's what the Eagles would look for, and that's part of the reason some folks are hoping they draft Bijan that high. But I think Gibbs at 30 isn't crazy. I don't know if there's a receiver in that range who necessarily would fit, and I don't know if receivers the way they want to go that early in the draft, because the mouths to feed becomes kind of an issue at that position. But I think an underrated possibility, and I don't think it's super likely, but The tight end position. This is a really good draft class for tight ends.
Yeah.
And I know everyone's going to say, yeah, they have Dallas Goedert. Goedert right now is older than Zach Ertz was when they drafted Goedert back in 2018 in the second round. So I don't think that's crazy. Now, you're limited a little bit because you're not going to play two tight end sets as much as you're going to play three wide. But I think that's a position that is really good in this draft. And it's been in the back of my mind. I don't think that would be totally crazy for them to draft a tight end, even if it's not at 30, somewhere in one of these first few rounds.
Yeah, Mayer at Notre Dame and Dalton Kincaid at Utah would be the two that come to mind.
Yeah, they might be gone. Play. You know, if you're talking about like maybe a modest trade down, okay. Darnell Washington.
Let me throw a name out for you later in the draft, right? Not tonight, but later in the draft, that I do know the Eagles like. Brenton Strange of Penn State.
Okay. Yeah, it's funny. The Eagles have, in their history, it's like they don't draft Penn State players. It's kind of crazy to have a pretty good football school not that far from you, and it's been rare. I mean, it's the last Penn State players they've drafted, Miles Sanders, obviously, Sharif Miller a few years ago, but we're talking a long lull between Penn State players for whatever reason.
Yeah, and part of it might be circumstances, too.
You know, yeah, I don't think there's like necessarily a cause and effect or a reason for it, but it is kind of strange that, you know, there's a pretty good football school on the other side of the state, and they don't seem to draft from it.
Okay, you know, it's interesting. Okay, for fun, odds that Howie makes a deal tonight?
Pretty good. He just that's what he does. He trades. You know, what do you want percentage wise? I think it's pretty high. I'd go like, because he has two picks too, so it's not like he just has one pick. I'd put it as high as like 70-75%. I'd be really surprised if he stayed at 10 and 30 and drafted players.
Interesting. I like it, Dave. I like it. Right?
Yeah. Matt's, I mean, look at history. He's made four trades in the last 5 years.
Absolutely.
Like, he doesn't sit still.
No. I mean, he may not be able to judge Jalen Reagor over Justin Jefferson, but he trades. I'm just kidding. Not everybody's perfect at this. I'm just joking. All right.
Yeah, no, you're right. I mean, that's a pretty big miss.
Yeah, but you know what? The Colts almost picked Ryan Leaf, too, so we'll leave that one off the board. They're not going to take a quarterback. They're not going to take a quarterback. But what have you thought as you sit there looking at it from 30,000 feet about the quarterback debate that's been going on with Stroud and Levis and Richardson and Bryce Young? What have you just thought as an observer?
It's been a really weird year with those quarterbacks, and I haven't done the work on them, really watching them much because I haven't needed to. I think there are some guys like, you know, I look at Richardson as a guy who, man, like the ceiling is so high for that dude. He's such a physical freak. I might take a chance on him over a guy like Levis. You know, at the top, I still think Bryce is going to go first. I think Stroud is really solid. I think those two are safer picks. But I look at Richardson and think, man, like that guy has so much talent. If he ends up in the right situation, and that's what so much of success kind of hinges on for a lot of positions, but especially quarterback, I think his ceiling is super high.
Matt, tell him who they should draft. Go ahead, Matt.
I am a Nolan Smith guy. That's who I would want as far as that goes.
Yeah, that's totally fine. He's a good edge rusher, and they can never have too many. And that's the thing. It's like if they draft an offensive lineman, there's a chance, like the best-case scenario is maybe they put someone really good to the bench. Whether, you know, if they draft Skoronski, he's probably starting at right guard, and that means that Cam Jurgens is going to have to wait his turn. Whereas, you know, if they draft an edge rusher, that guy's playing. He's not going to start, probably, at least not right away, because they have Reddick and Sweat. But he's going to play. He's going to play an awful lot. So I think there are reasons to want that player. And someone like Nolan Smith can grow into that starter role eventually, and you hope he's here for the next decade.
Dave, were you actually physically there when they had the draft in Philadelphia?
I didn't go to the actual draft. I've never actually gone to the actual draft. That could,
okay.
It just makes more
Neither
sense for me to be at the facility. But it was a pretty cool scene from just watching it on TV.
Yeah, I mean, neither have I. I've never gone to a draft either. I just, but it sounds like it's, they're getting 250, 500,000 people just to watch them hand up cards. That's pretty good.
Yeah, the NFL is going to find ways to make money on whatever they can. And it's crazy how big of a business the draft has become. You read like old stories about when guys would get drafted and they'd send a letter to their colleges and say, oh yeah, you got drafted in the 14th round, show up for training camp in a few months. Like it's amazing how far it's come.
What's it like covering the draft when you're at the facility? Can you just give everybody at least an insight as to, like your chair and what's going on there?
Sure. I don't know what it's like in some other buildings. The Eagles, I'll be there kind of doing some TV, some radio, and kind of waiting for these picks. And I have a little desk at the facility, so we'll wait for them to make moves. We'll kind of work as they make the moves. And then at the end of the day, they'll have a press conference with the general manager and the head coach. And, that's typically the way they do it. They used to come out with some coach after every pick, just kind of explain it. And they haven't done that in a few years. It's kind of at the end of the day, they'll explain everything they've done.
Well, Dave, I think we lost Steve again. I really appreciate the insight. Appreciate your time, especially on a busy day today. And we'll definitely catch up with you soon. Thanks so much for the time.
All right, thanks.